because last week, one of the students came up to me and started asking me questions about Patty Smith. She thought I was the same who spoke last week. So I'm not. Much better looking. And I wanted to remind you that I'm John Cornfeld, and I'm kind of the ringmaster, if you will, of the course. We're about halfway through the course, and before I introduce Dean Butler, I wanted to say a few words. And I'm kind of waiting. Thanks. So I've been a classroom teacher for 16 years, as I think I told you on the first day and the previous day. I was 20 to 35 to 20 years ago. So it's a long time ago. But I still kind of think about, I try to imagine challenges that students are having and try to address them. So we're about at the midpoint of the semester, and I thought I would take a few minutes to just reflect a little on the course. In some ways, it's a difficult course. In other ways, it's not. I was thinking about Thurston, as I was driving in today. One of the hardest things about this course is that it begins at 8 in the morning. And that's killing me. I don't know about the rest of you. I live about an hour away, and just getting here is a challenge. And it's 2 hours long. And there's no food, which most of us are used to eating and drinking. I'm not allowed to bring a water bottle in here. That's hard. For those of you who live on campus, it's a challenge just getting here. I wish you didn't drive. I think it would be less of a challenge, but that's going to be your choice, ultimately. But it's not easy. It's a big lecture hall. It's huge. And although this is a spectacular place, it doesn't change the fact that the people in the back have no connection to the speaker up front. It really requires incredible focus to listen and get something out of it. I acknowledge that. It's always better to be in a room with 20 people in a circle discussing readings or ideas than it is to be in a hall of this size unless you happen to be listening to something that really kind of hits you. Another challenge is there are only 8 PAs. You would hope to have a few more than that, and so that there would be a personal connection. The PA, is it 8? Is that the right number? Is it 8? Yeah, I mean, they're doing a fantastic job. And they're getting like 50 emails a day from you, but it's really hard for them to get to know you and to be provide that kind of personal connection. So that's a challenge. Another challenge is the technology, Moodle. Some of you are really familiar with it, and one thing we're learning is that some of you are not familiar with it, and it's proving to be a challenge. And you have to read directions online. I know a lot of you looked at the volunteer sign-up page, and you just saw all this print, all this text, and you just freaked out. You didn't. It just looked like it looked confusing, and hopefully you contacted your peers and got help on that. But that's a challenge too. It's a challenge to have to do your learning online to remember to go every week and to do that. So I recognize that, and I really want to acknowledge the 50 to 75% of you who come every time, come to your seats, sit down, listen. Even if the presentation doesn't seem all that interesting, you listen for information that might be useful to you or interesting or valuable. I want to acknowledge the people who are doing all the readings, who bought the book, the Patty Smith book, who read it, and maybe you got something out of it, maybe you didn't, but then when you came to the lecture, you got something out of it from the lecture. That's most of you in here. I also want to, I want to give you kind of an example. The lecture on the 27th of the class that was also coinciding with the economic conference. There was a lot of speech defined. Some of it was interesting and some of it wasn't. But I want to tell you about a couple of students, maybe 5 students, 6 that I talked to right towards the end of the panel. And I had been upstairs the whole time, but I came down right near the end of the panel, and I was waiting outside the door, and a student came up to me and said, "I've got to talk to the couple of women. What she said has changed my life. I now know what I want to do with my life. I came here, I was sort of looking at my phone, and then I heard something, and I started listening, and it's not a direct quote, but that's kind of what I got from her. Is there a way I can talk to her?" And I said, "Well, you know, I'll talk to Dean Silver, and I'll see if he knows her, and he can get her number." He said, "No, I need to talk to her now. Right now, as soon as she's done talking." And I said, "Okay, I'll see what I can do." And while we were waiting for the panel to finish, four or five other students came up and sort of were saying the same thing. "I've got to talk to the Cheese guy." That was the, "Got to talk to him. He said some things that I really want to talk to him about. I want to ask him about. I'm thinking about a possibility for, going into business. Whatever." So I actually waited until the panel was over, and then I went out and I found them, each of them, and when I said there were a couple of students who wanted to talk to them, they said, "Hey," they just went right up, and I just introduced them, and then I left. I don't really know what came of it. But those were students who came here, came to that class, and sort of waited through whatever they found interesting or not interesting, but something hit them, something unexpected. And this did change their life, but that's kind of the way it works. I'm not going to moralize about it. I'm not going to tell you what you should or shouldn't do. Well, I'm going to tell you a couple of things, but in terms of the level of interest that you want to give to a class, that's up to you. Okay? So I want to address first some challenges to make sure that we're all on the same page. And then I'm also going to talk a little bit about kind of what I saw when I was up on the third floor. But first I want to talk about Moodle, because I think we maybe misjudged your sophistication. Facebook is one thing, but Moodle is another. And I want to make sure that you are aware that a great deal of information about the course is here, in Moodle. There, in Moodle. And if you don't, and we can look and see how often you access it. And there are some people who haven't gone on for weeks. And if you don't go on for weeks, it's going to be very hard for you to pass this class. So I want to just direct your attention to a couple little things. And I know you can't see it very well, but you can see it when you're home. One of the important parts is the syllabus. Parts of this are not up to date, but I'm going to show you one part that is very important and is up to date, and that is the course requirements. It actually lists, it lists all of the assignments and what the percentage is for that assignment. Now, some of the descriptions are up to date, and some of them aren't, and I'll tell you where they are up to date. But for instance, attendance, that's 20% of your grade. You just need to show up. Now, you get three freebies, but after that, it starts to drop precipitously. The value. You get 0% for 20% of your grade, it's going to be very hard to pass this class. And maybe that's something that we should have said on the first day. I guess we didn't quite realize that you weren't all rushing to the computer so that you rushed this class to find out what things were worth. Every quiz is worth 10%. And you only have 45 minutes to take them. And you have to prepare ahead of time. Or else, I know what you can do is you can quickly go to the readings and see if you can find it. And if you're really fast, I'm not going to tell you how to study. If you know how to study, if you're able to get everything you need during that 45 minutes and pass it, right? But if you're not, you're going to need to read ahead of time. Now, I know there's been a little bit of confusion because you have 8 instructors, and that's one of the other challenges of the course. Each instructor does it a little differently. Each has a different lecture style, each has slightly different requirements, and each, if they give a test, may give you a different window That information is going to be on here. I'm going to show you where it is. But it also gets fed by the instructor, by the dean here in the class. So if you hear it, you'll know. So it's really important that you pay attention to that, because I know there have been some issues, and that reminds me of something else. If you get an error message, if you feel like Moodle actually did something that messed you up, take a screenshot of it. You know, get your phone and take a picture of it, or do the screenshot with the computer if you know how to do that, and then show it to one of your TAs. But, you know, show some evidence that you actually ran into a technological glitch. And then we'll do what we can to help you. But unless you have a doctor's note, once that window is closed, it's closed. And you know, we've had some panicked students, and we've made some exceptions at times. If they contacted us right away, right after the test, or even during the test window, I had a problem. But from now on, no, because I'm saying it here. You're going to have to make sure that you know when the window is, that you're ready when you log on to the test, because you will only have 45 minutes. Okay, so I said something about attendance, and I said something about the volunteer project. There are a lot of you who still haven't signed up. 50 of you are gone right now because they're doing a volunteer project that is scheduled right now. But there are a lot of you sitting in the room who have not signed up for the project. That's what percent? That's 10% of your grade. I'm going to show you where you can. I hope I'm going to be able to get that. Let's see. We'll get back to the main part of the course. All the most up-to-date directions are actually listed in the context of the daily schedule. So you would need to go back to Dean Alley's week that he was here, and that will give you the instructions that you need. If you have problems, you can check with your TA, but they'll just direct you back to exactly where you need to be. Did you want to tell me something I should say here? Okay. Yeah, I have a couple of TAs to make sure that I give you the correct information here. But you really do need to see what you need to do on the day. And, you know, what would be really good is if you actually look a couple of days before you come to class, see what the readings are, do the readings, and then come prepared. And if you're expecting to do something outside, like the volunteer assignment, if you follow the instructions, they're pretty clear. But if you're having problems, contact your TA. But there, as I say, there are 200 or 300 of you who have not yet signed up for a volunteer project. So, any questions about this? Is there something I've left out? It's very important that you continually go on to Moodle to see what's expected of you. Okay, so the TA's over here helping us. Now, I want to address one more thing before I introduce Dean Butler. And that is the behavior in this room. I taught middle school for 8 years, and I'm actually amazed that I'm having to say this, because I feel like I'm back in middle school again. I really felt that way when I was upstairs. I felt like I was at a middle school assembly. I want to say I'm not speaking to all of you. In fact, I'm speaking to a fairly small percentage of you. Most of you were great. But I want to kind of tell you what I saw on Wednesday. The first thing was when students came in. That was interesting. Get your cards, come in here and mingle, and then go into the hall. Well, 50 to 100 of you just got your cards and left. I'm being slightly sarcastic, but I actually prefer that to what I saw up there, which was people staring at their phones or computers the entire time. That wasn't so great, but it wasn't as bad as the third type that I saw up there. fairly small percentage, maybe 15-20%, but that's the critical mass. That's a lot of people. What were they doing? They were talking to each other non-stop. I'm talking about 2 hours of talking. Looking at their computers, laughing, handing it off to somebody else. That didn't happen in middle school when I was teaching middle school because we have computers. And I acknowledge that phones and computers are a distraction. My text with somebody, during that 2 hours, that can be done in a very unobtrusive way. I'm not going to tell you what you have to do in terms of listening. I'm not going to say that you have to come in and you have to have an epiphany like the few people that I spoke to whose lives were changed. But what you must do is you must let everybody else learn who wants to learn. And what that means is, if you want to figure out a way to game the system, cut class, or get it discounted and somehow disappear, we're not going to chase after you. We have too many students to account for to do that. So, if you're able to game the system, go to game it, as long as you're not bothering other people. If you want to come in and quietly look at your phone the whole time, go on Facebook, whatever, I don't think that's a great idea. I think it's rude to the speakers, but, you can't see what you're doing in the back. Do it. But do it quietly. What will not be tolerated anymore is people talking to each other. It is out of hand towards the back. And what got me doing all this investigating, what got me doing this in the first place was, first the TAs were saying to me, there are some students who are really making, being annoying. I'm little here up front, and I don't hear anything. There could be 20 people talking in the back right now, and I wouldn't know it. But everybody up here, of course, they tend to be fairly, they're listening. They know that they can be seen. But then what started happening is students started kind of talking to me. Last week alone, I had about 20 students either email me or come to my office and say, I'm sick of this. I'm trying to listen, and I can't focus because people around me are talking. And when I ask them to stop, they either ignore me or they insult me. And that's just not fair. That's what you must not do. That's the deal. If you can sit quietly in your seats, nobody's going to bother you. But don't hand your computers over to somebody else to show them something that's funny. Save it until after class, okay? And if a TA asks you to leave, you will need to leave. Because we are going to make sure that everybody in this room has the chance to listen and to learn if they so choose. Okay. Any questions? I really hate to sort of project this kind of image to you. I'm really excited about the possibilities here, and I'm also aware of some of the challenges that you have. And if you are having challenges, please feel free to contact me, and I will do what I can to make it right. And I'm really excited about the direction that we're going with this course. And with that, I want to introduce Dean Butler, who is going to talk about technology. And I think that, as I've already said, that technology presents all kinds of possibilities, but also challenges. When I was a classroom teacher, nobody had cell phones. I didn't have a cell phone. It creates great challenges, but also great opportunities. So, Dean Butler. You can clap. Oh, was that for me? No. Excellent. Hey, all right. Okay. So now I'm going to first introduce her, and then you can clap for her. Thank you. Dean Butler joined the library faculty in 1994 and has served as dean of the university library for the past 13 years. She earned a Master's of Library and Information Science from the University of Hawaii, Honolulu in 1971 and a Bachelor of Arts in Political Science and Economics from McGill, that's in Montreal, Canada, from 94 to 99. Dean Butler was a librarian in the Salazar Library at Sonoma State. that Salazar Hall used to be the library. She held previous library positions at the University of Nevada at Reno, as well as posts at various institutions in Hawaii. Among them, and I'm going to butcher the names, Seminole University in Honolulu, Kanohi Regional Library in Kanohi, Hawaii. What island is that on?
Oahu.
And Hawaii Lower College in Kanohi. While in Hawaii, she taught courses in information and literacy at various branch campuses at the University of Hawaii on the Outer Islands. Prior to graduate school in library and information science, Dean Butler spent a semester traveling to Pacific Islands while studying in the MA in Pacific History program. With the move to Source Information Center in 2000, she transformed the library into an active learning center, highly collaborative in nature, which has built and supported academic success at Sonoma State. Dean Butler has been the keeper of the library for the last 13 years. And it's been really great working with her all these years.
As you know, the theme of this class is change. And in my opinion, nowhere has change been more evident than in this. But I don't call it the disciplines in the field or in the area of information and by extension in libraries. So, really, that's what our lives are all about now, and it's pretty challenging. I'm sure, as you probably know, you've seen a lot of this, but for some of us who've grown up in the time of taking notes by hand, this has been huge. And the one thing you will know is the acceleration. It's huge. When I attended the conference last week, I took down a couple of words that I thought were kind of meaningful, or should be meaningful for you all as you pursue your academic program, and even more in your lives ahead. And I think that was the main takeaway from that conference, even though it was But here are some of the things I wrote down. Communication, teamwork, develop your insights, develop a context. I'm going to say something about that in a minute. Give back. A lot of those small companies give back to the community. Energy. Think globally. And you know what I say, think globally, outwardly. That was very apparent, I think, to those companies. Change as the new normal. And Sandy Weil, the beginning speaker, talked about all the opportunities in this particular area, and that's what those speakers were about to panel around the small companies, smallish in this area. Be mindful. You know what that means? Being mindful means you're paying attention, you're not passive. You're sitting, observing things because you may not care about a particular class right now, but that is going to serve you well when you get out there in what is now an extremely competitive world. And you can learn to do that. I think that speaks to really some of the things that Dr. Kornfeld was just saying to you. You want to be mindful of your surroundings. You want to think about the context that you're developing, because that is really going to help. Mingle. And Sandy Weil, I noticed right away, spoke to all of you, although you were many of you up there, and said, you the students, are the teachers. So there should be plenty of motivation there. If you didn't enjoy that conference, then take it away. But I think you will find messages in almost everything you attend if you pay attention. We have two classes around information and by extension libraries. And I want to point out that, first of all, I'm not going to teach you how to use the library. I don't believe in doing that because it's not going to take hold until you have a need. It's demand driven. And I'm going to assume that even if a good number of you are freshmen, you're already in English 101 or English 100 or whatever, and so you've had some kind of introduction to that too. Anybody not had an introduction to the library? The short version? No, so you've all had some kind of introduction, and I assume you've all been there too. So you may not have used the library, but you haven't been in there even. About developing their content, that is an extremely important method for how you become what I consider information savvy. So it's not about knowing facts, because those facts are going to change. It's about learning strategies. And information savvy would get you through life, but that means that you have to constantly listen, develop a broad context, absorb what you're hearing even on the news, and you do have to pay attention. So we have today and we have Wednesday. That's it for information and by extension libraries. Today we'll talk mostly about information, and this room is what's invited on. So we should go through some of this, and then before we begin for the day, I'll tell you a little bit about some assignments. B, because it's a fabulous sound opening. And if you don't know about 2001, it was made in 1968, a little bit before your time, and it's a British and American film. Now, it's a bit futuristic, or at least it was in those days. And I thought it was pretty scary, actually. It was different because it used a visual sound instead of dialogue. And that was kind of edgy. That soundtrack was actually, you may know this, the three brand new balls of figuring the film. This one is Johann Strauss, Richard Strauss's which was unusual. Those were classical pieces that were used for this opening. And now, what is this, 40? At least 40 years later, it's considered one of the, it's had a cult following. It's considered a very major film because of its technique and because it was scientifically accurate at the time. That is to say, it rolled together what they knew and then what they imagined, which is fabulous. The themes were evolution, technology, artificial intelligence. If you haven't seen it, you might look at it. I mean, it's a little odd today, but it's pretty amazing at the time. Okay, that is just exciting. So, let me see if I can get over here. So what we're going to do here is take a quick tour through the evolution of information through history. And what you'll see, I hope what you'll see, is over time, The acceleration is incredible. So here we are looking at what we can call the dawn of information. And this goes back to 3500 BCE. Everybody know what BCE is? Anyone want to define it? Excellent. Where is that coming from? Good. Before the Common Era. It used to be that you achieved BC before Christianity. And now in our current age, actually since about 1700, it's being referred to as the Common Era, in order to be sensitive to non-Christians, which is the purpose of it. But BC looks a little unusual. Now, you saw this image with Dr. Ayala. And, you know, when he was talking about the beginning of education, he happened to show this play tablet from Sumer, or Sumer's house for now. Do you remember what that is? Do you remember where that is? Anybody? No? All right. It was Mesopotamia, current-day Iraq. And that is that area, that is one of the areas that's considered the cradle of civilization. So not surprising that things of this sort would develop because they were really ahead of much of the rest of the world. There was a whole other cradle of civilization, and that was in India and also in China. So then we moved up a little bit. I can't remember whether Dr. Ayala said this in his realm, but now we're talking about hieroglyphic writing. So again, this is your recording, the recording and distribution of information. Now, hieroglyphic refers to a combination of alphabet and also what I think of as symbolic or pictographs, logographs. They are symbols that represent a word or a concept. So there's a mix, and it was very beautiful using ancient Egypt. I have to explain this one because 2500 BCE, early form of ink, in use in China. Well, this image is not from that age, is it? This is a terracotta warrior from the first emperor of China, the Han Dynasty. And the reason why, first of all, this is absolutely fabulous. Has anyone seen those? Somebody has? Excellent. Right now at the Asian Art Museum in San Francisco, there is an exhibit of some of these statues that are unbelievable, absolutely unbelievable. But this was the time in history that the evidence of development of ink was found in China. And it was an official of the Han Dynasty who had something to do with this, and what they discovered was that the ink that was produced was made from sick and animal fluid. Sounds awful. The reality is that many ancient civilizations independently discovered and developed ink, and that was an important and very important development in terms of distributing information. This is Herodotus and the Babylonians. This is around 2,000 years BCE for calculations that could be used again, and that is important in this information distribution. Now, you all know this probably. The Museum of Alexandria, also known as the Library of Alexandria, either the Royal Library or the Ancient Library, both by a couple of terms, but it was monumental, but was stupendous. This is just an artist's rendering because they don't actually know exactly what it looked like. There are bits and pieces of information, but it The ancient Bible of Alexandria actually developed a lot of myths around it, a lot of myths and legends, because you remember Julius Caesar got involved, right? It's Cleopatra. But it was a fabulous gathering of the known scholarship at the time. And it flourished in the 3rd century BC until the Roman conquest of Egypt in 40 BC. And then it was destroyed. They're not entirely sure exactly how. There are a number of different tales attached to that. But the actual facts may be lost to history. It was intended to be a center for scholarship, and it was actually intended to promote the wealth of Egypt and the preeminence of Egypt. And it was symbolic and very amazing. Now, the Chinese again. You can see the development in both the Middle East and in the heart of China. The Chinese developed, as I've noted, they developed a process for making paper early on, this is BCE, 2nd century, and eventually it reached Central Asia. So you know that you can record information, but how you record it and how it's distributed is what makes a difference in the development of civilization and learning. Now we fast forward a little bit. This is getting into our Eurocentric view here. This is William the First of England, and how many of you have heard of the Dane Sailboat? Any of you? One person has, but see, I come from Canada, so I learned British history, not American history. And this is a major development. 1086, it was completed. And what it was a record, at the time, a survey, like a census would be, of all the land holdings and all the wealth. And it was noted, it was written in Latin. It's actually in a book that is now archived in Southwest London. And it captured the ownership and the wealth of the time. And the thing about it is that it stopped in time then the record of who had what. And that became the law. So there was no appeal to that. And that meant that the recorded future land wealth was what placed you in the social status. And 1086, that was a long time ago. Now we move forward, and you did hear some of those from DNIR. This is the Gutenberg Bibles, the first, actually he invented, he's credited with inventing the printing press. Movable type. That's why there's an image there. And it's pretty neat. But that's the printing press. And this is in Germany. This is in the middle of the 15th century. And it had an unbelievable, talk about game changers. That was the theme of the conference. This was a huge game changer. What it did was movable type was fast, relatively fast, as opposed to woodblock printing or writing by hand. It was suitable, too, for the smaller alphabets that were used in the European languages. So it caught on like wildfire, and it's amazing what it did to the distribution of information. This is one of the absolute major events. And I'm going to give you a few little notes here, because this is incredible, I think. Within only a few decades, within 50 or 60 years of the invention of the printing press, the entire classical canon, the entire classical canon was available. People, so remember, before, only certain people had access to, only few people had access to written work. And when that constrained education, and that constrained in the market, perceive, and being able to think more broadly. When this happened, and it took a couple of hundred years, but the numbers were staggering. It exploded. And the printing started to become the norm. Now, still, what was produced from that tended to land in the hands of the well-to-do or the educated. But the speed at which that spread was incredible. And that meant the democratizing of knowledge, which is a major, major impact on historical development. So it's credited with leading to the Renaissance, it's credited with the development of scientific knowledge, which was another key to moving civilization forward. And I know you heard about the printing press, but what's so interesting is the speed again, that acceleration. Old Encyclopedia Britannica. It's published in 1768. And last year, they ceased their print production, which is another sign of the time. They are digital only now. But they were published in print in those sort of iconic volumes for quite a few hundred years. And the reason why it has stood the test of time is because the Britannica is considered the most scholarly of the English language encyclopedias. And it has always had, we'll talk about Wikipedia next week, I mean, it's mental. The Britannica has always had editors, very high-end editors who confer the content, who check for it. So while you could say it was a book crowd source, because they had many components, it doesn't have the same nature as Wikipedia. It has the power of its own. I love Wikipedia. Now, the printing press and the way that the speed with which it could reproduce, and then the development in paper bleaching, is what gave rise to mass production of magazines, especially, and newspapers. So I know you can't see this here. This is Harper's Weekly, that's been around for a long time. This edition is 1857. Definitely, 1857. You can see this if you open up the PowerPoint on Moodle. And tonight's 21st, 1857. And at price, 5 cents. And the lead headline there is, "Are we as great a country as we think we are?" Doesn't that sound contemporary? 1857. But now we're into the age of newspapers that are widely available. And then there's the American side of printing. This is the first time, this is 1813, this is the first time that there were printed orders for the U.S. Army. And this is information distribution. And what this says is, Rangers and United States Volunteers, so this was by rank, and this is just a register. You won't be able to see, but if you go online, you'll be able to see that about the 6th or 7th person down on the left side is getting the boom. So I guess you didn't check that. So that was the record of the time that year. So, continuing forward now, you might get a little bit of this in your next classes, which are going to be completely online. And this is the difference engine, which is a precursor to the modern computer. And Charles Babbage is the inventor, and he was an English mechanical engineer, and he is credited with the programmable computer. That is 1822. This is early too, 1897. Marconi was Italian, and and the company is not, I'm not sure if it's Guillermo, 1874 to 1937. So he was an Italian inventor, and came from a very good family. He ended up sharing the Nobel Prize in 1909 in physics. But this is really the development of telegraphy, which became very important. And led to television. So, it won't surprise you, now this is from the BBC, this is back in time. Television has been an incredible medium for advertising, you know that, for entertainment, for news, and it has formed public opinion, it still does, although we're moving now to streaming video, but in the old days, this was an incredible new invention that really captured the public. Now, there weren't terribly many television receivers to start with. And when I was born in Montreal, we didn't have television in Eastern Canada until New York began streaming communicating, broadcasting, I should say, television channels. And we used to pick up the channel from Oxford, New York, and Burlington, Vermont, because we didn't yet have it in the US. So I remember those days. It's a very strange addiction. The telephone, I think you probably know Alexander Graham Bell. He's credited as being the inventor of the telephone, but he wasn't the only one who worked on it. So there are a number of major names in telephone development. As it developed, it is now considered among the most widely used appliances in the developed world. I don't have an image here, but I'm going to imagine that many of you have seen that image of a child earlier in Kenya. Before I know, with a cell phone. Just an amazing image that shows that what it's like to be able to communicate among other people. So we're coming at information, but now we're into communication. That's really what this is all about. And from talking drums in Africa to the distant kind of communication that we can enjoy now. So the progress of information is, these are really a bit arbitrary, these categories. However, when Telstar satellites were launched in 1962, they were taken launch, they were able to make broadcasts of images and sound from a real distance, in many different areas. What it will do is process digital data on a single circuit, programmable device. So, this is a great picture, Steve Jobs, don't you think? 1976, Apple sells the first computer, and you know where that led. Now, they had a very successful history to start with, and then they kind of declined. Now, Apple went into decline for a while until what? Somebody say? The iPhone, the iPad. They had some stops along the way in between the start of the personal computers and PC developments. And then, of course, they now have lost their major leader there. And then, look, she's right on this question. Okay, so we move forward here. Today, researchers estimate that global information consumption exceeds, I can't even figure this out, 9.57 petabytes. Anybody know what that is? can look it up on Wikipedia. It's 10 to the 25th power of byte. It means nothing, right? But it's 10. So, so if you look these up on the web, you will find various estimates because really it's impossible to estimate exactly. It's just impossible because it's moving by the hour. Okay, the dawn of the internet. I think probably most of you will know that in 1969, it was the Department of Defense that began in ARPANET, well, ARPANET, the precursor to the internet, and they started with four nodes, just four nodes, Stanford, UCLA, UC Santa Barbara, and Utah, to connect the information stream. And you can tell the development since then. So the Telecommunications Act of 1996 was very important. It was signed by Clinton, and the primary goal was the deregulation of the converging broadcasting and telecommunications market. And for the first time, it included the internet, and it opened it up. So then it spread like wildfire, including providing access to libraries and schools. It was very important to get that out to the people. You know the rest of the story with that. 2008. Well, these again are just estimates. 70 million websites. 4 years later, over 630 thousand, and I'm sure it's much beyond that at this point. So the last slide here is the one that is important to you, should be important to you. And that is that we are considered to be now in the age of big data. More important than ever before. It's been your fact all your lives. It already is in some ways. By 2020, our digital universe will be 34 times as big. Now, I had a reading on the website, on the moon site. Let me know if you can't find it. Because there's a very good article in the New York Times, it'd be about a year old now, that defines big data and talks about, I want to read you the opening sentence here. This, by the way, is New York Times, February 11th, 2012. The opening line is good with numbers. Fascinated by data, the sound you hear is opportunity knocking. And it goes on to talk about how big data is affecting all fields of work, every part of our lives. Of course, obviously science and business, but these are important. This is part of the context with which you are going to be dealing, or already are dealing. So what I'd like you to do is read this article before Wednesday. It's you do the print version of 6 pages, but it's very good. It really is understandable, gives you a definition, and I would submit extremely important for developing context, regardless of where you're heading in life, because this is your changing environment, and big data, you're going to hear that phrase quite a bit now. Let me know if you can't open that on Middle. Information and knowledge today. Now, this is, we've done the fast tour of history. This is more about the concept of knowledge and information and how it's changing. And I want to introduce you, I'm not, by the way, asking you to get this book or expecting you to read it, but I'd like you to know about it. It's called Too Big to Know, Now That the Facts, Rethinking Knowledge, Now That the Facts Aren't the Facts, Experts Are Everywhere, and the Smartest Person in the Room is the Room. And how do you give off of the title? Now, what is the first thing we do when we come upon a new source? Anybody? Want to guess? Want to comment? Well, here's your first lesson in information. You check out the author. You want to check the credentials of the person who's put together this provocative title. Who the heck is he? So I will tell you, his name is David Weinberger, and he's a senior researcher at Harvard University's Berkman Center for the Internet Society. And if you do a Google search for his biography, you will discover that he's a philosopher. And that's not surprising, because philosophers deal in big ideas. He had all of his academic degrees in philosophy from major institutions. But he has a perfect argument. He wrote scripts for Woody Allen for a while. And he's written a number of books, and of course he does a lot of speaking. He wrote small pieces, loosely joined, everything is miscellaneous, maybe for the work in education, manifesting. He's my new favorite author, because he can take those big ideas and break them down. Now, what this is about is, where are we going with the internet? Where is information, i.e. knowledge, going with the internet? Much change. So, here is his point. Historically, in the Gutenberg age, because of the finite nature of the book, and that was printing paper, knowledge was older than hierarchical. It was also slow, limited by the number of pages and the number of copies that could be printed. And the author added pieces to the collective story of knowledge. Now that, you can see that he's setting up a different condition these days. So it was very limited. And he calls it knowing by revision. That is to say, there was so much information and knowledge then that you couldn't possibly absorb it. But there were entities that limited that information for you. And so there was an elaborate system of editorial, curatorial, which means taken care of, or library, professional filters that limited much of what's written from being published. So that was like mimicking that fire hose. What landed in people's hands was a very tiny percentage of what was produced. And so what you had access to was decided by others. And went into books, which were expensive to publish. Again, it was sort of a snapshot in time, because it wasn't easy to republish or edit them. It would take a while. So, Weinberger's statement of knowing by revision, and this, by the way, is an old graphic that you may have seen before, called GIKW. That is, the bottom layer is data, second layer is information, then knowledge, then wisdom. So, this is the reducing phenomenon. His point is that raising the bar has sometimes exploded ideas really worth knowing. And that's going to be an important point in what he says. So, this would be obvious, but with the modern traditional knowledge, paper doesn't allow easy correcting. So therefore, it was carefully vetted. That means editors or publishers decided what would be published. It was checked out. It was expensive to publish, therefore you wouldn't winnow out contenders. And if knowledge was published on paper, which it was for centuries, then there had to be places to store those. And that is one of the roles of libraries, also known as repositories. But in time, right? Today, now this is Weinberger's main point. Today, it's the connecting of knowledge, the networking, that is changing our oldest, most basic strategy of knowing. And he explains it by saying we are now knowing by including every idea in vast, mostly connected web. when you think about that, what should strike you is the power of the community. Along with the map, there's a huge power in this. The internet has radically knocked down the walls of the knowledge store. But what we have now, which is, by the way, a term that's been used for a long time, information overload, information anxiety, information flood, information tsunami, name it, it's been out there in the book title. There's an interesting, this kind of sort of kind of page here. In the 1600s, which I find really interesting. In 1885, a French scholar wrote, "We have reason to fear that the multitude of books which go very well This is what you're living with now. Instead of reducing information and hiding what doesn't make it true, teachers now increase the information and reveal the urgent truth. This is what it looks like. This lawyer was in D.C. this morning. This image is from an article in Atlantic magazine that Weinberger wrote on big data in science. And this is such a fabulous group. These are actually porn stars. And I don't know if you can see that poor little beast under the light there, because it's about to come to light. So too big to know is the thing. So knowledge now is taking on a new shape. It's not the pyramid that reduces to just a small amount at the top. It's taking on the net, the network. And the characteristics of this, interesting to think about, very wide, it's populous, and means it's of the people, boundary-free, unsettled, other credentials. So remember, when you were publishing in print, you often had to pass through lots of credential checks. Now, you can publish out there, on the net. And so, the expansion is free. But it's a change in how to think about it. So the new shape of knowledge is a messy model, works at every scale, but doesn't have a foundation like printed information did. So, and again, this point, it makes it easier for us to go wrong. Now, this is the element that you need to be conscious of as you think about your academic career and going forward. It's more difficult to nail down conclusions because there are always other facts supporting other interpretations. And that is an important observation. So, knowledge lives not in books, or in minds, or in games, but in the network itself. By that, he means the internet enables groups to develop ideas well beyond a single individual. And you probably have seen examples of this. Properties of the internet connect to lots of people. Sometimes called crowdsourcing, if you are putting them on a project, many different kinds of people, and therefore it's very diverse. And network conversations and social relationships among diversely talented people is what makes it powerful. Equals the fact that expertise multiplies. It's just in a messy way. Internet is cumulative because it doesn't remove any of the content. It's an interesting new model of the power of knowledge. Attached to that, expertise used to be topic-based. But now we're in an environment where anyone can publish. All of you can publish, and in fact, you do. And you don't go through the publishing in print cycle. You're probably on a blog, or you're doing something of that sort. So there's a new model emerging, and these are the characteristics. Credentials instead of credentials. That makes it democratic. You don't go through those official filters, those official sign-offs. From consistency to plenitude, that makes it difficult. From certitude to ambivalence, not published in a book where you see that fact on the page. And then from capacity conferred by authority, to a constant demand for transparency, and from contained, unknowable, to linked, and unmasterable. So, hard to handle. Very hard to handle. We're used to it. But one of the things that you want to think about is that, remember we said it's wide? And here's an interesting little fact. When British media needed to pour through tens of thousands of pages of parliamentarian expense reports, they crowdsourced it. And made them engage thousands of people rather than relying on a handful of experts. It turns out that with a big enough population engaged, sufficient notes can be a tone deaf. In parentheses, he says, note that this is not particularly good news for the parliamentarian will or expenses. Here's another one, boundary free. Evaluating patent applications. Can't be crowdsourced because it would require expertise that the crowds don't have. So when the U.S. Patent Office, and this is the reality, was frustrated by how long its beleaguered staff was taking to research patent applications, it started a pilot project that enlists citizen experts to find prior instances of the claimed invention. That pilot is now a standard process of patent business. And it goes on to talk about the other characteristics. Infrastructure for knowledge. Because now we've talked about the fact that we have a messy model that is boundless, doesn't have the same foundation. One day there feels that the new strategy of knowledge improves rather than excludes. Very important because it involves all of you. It's a new world that we're living in that we didn't when we were going through our academic program. Open up access, we'll talk about that on Monday. Provide the rich for intelligence, make everything, leave no institution behind, no institution knowledge behind, and teach everyone. By teaching everyone, that's teaching everyone how to access and how to discern what's important. So, my last point here would be critical thinking skills are more important than ever. Because we're living in information overload in a bloodthirsty world. Okay, finish with that. Let's talk a little bit about Wednesday, because apropos what John was saying, I started to put an assignment up on the middle page, but I do need to tweak it a little bit. So it will probably be afternoon today, after lunchtime today, that I'll have it ready. I may expand it a little bit. What I'd like to ask you to do, and this will count for participation, it's not going to be a quiz. It's going to be an exercise that you will do on your own. And my suggestion is that, because I'm not going to take you on a library tour, because you already know all that, I'd like you to go in the library's website and get to know it a little bit. And then what I'd like you to do, outsource our website. We have a huge challenge, as you probably know, many people do, with website design, because it changes all the time. Navigation is difficult. When you are developing a library website, it's extra hard because you're trying to bring in external information. So what I'm going to ask you to do, and I'll word it a little more carefully after lunchtime, is to use the library's website, follow some of the links, continue to spend a little time, and then develop some ideas about how it could be better. Tell us what your suggestions are. Tell me what your suggestions are. What would make more sense? What's missing? What doesn't follow through easily for you? And I'm going to ask you to post that. Some ideas on that, but I'll expand that assignment, and that you can do on your own time. We'll see how that goes. You have until the weekend to do that, so we'll talk a little more about it on Wednesday. The other assignment is to age the big data that I mentioned to you, the New York Times article, which is linked on the middle side. But if you have a problem with it, let me know. Because I do think that's an important article for you to peruse. It's about your life and what it will become. So, be developing that context and that mindfulness around what your world is. Because you're going to have a long time that you need to be strategic with information. Okay. I'm going to stop there. Okay. Yes. You can take the floor.
Just a couple more. Just take a couple more minutes. Can you hear me? Around this area of information literacy and the sort of availability of the net, have you heard the term digital natives? Is that a term you're familiar with? Have you heard the term millennials? Which you are, right? Millennials are people who came of age around the millennium, or actually in this case, you're with some millennials that are quite a bit older than you at this point. But the notion of a digital native is somebody who has all of his life or her life has lived in a digital world and has had access to digital technology in order to access information. We're not digital natives. My mother, who's 92 years old, there's a term for that. She is a digital, digital outsider. To just think about how the digital world really impacts the way you look at things. And I'll give you an example from my mother, who's 92 years old. And one time I was driving somewhere with my wife and my daughter and my mother, and we couldn't find a parking space, and my mother doesn't walk well at all. So we dropped her off, I dropped her off with my daughter and my wife, and then I went out to park the car. And, of course, there was nothing to worry about. I had my cell phone, my wife and daughter had their cell phones. We were going to find each other, right? It wasn't a problem. There was a farmer's market in Los Angeles, a big place, a lot of action there. But my mother was terrified. She was upset that we had left without discussing a meeting place, without working things out ahead of time. That's more technology than information. But the reason why I bring it up is that the technology actually shapes the way you negotiate your world. A similar example, but where it was catastrophic was, or semi-catastrophic, was when my daughter and her friend were traveling in Europe and got separated, and they hadn't gone. They didn't have things. That was actually a few years ago, and it was before your cell phones like worked automatically in another. It's still the case. You might go somewhere and your cell phone might not work. They were on the first day in London, and they got separated, and they had no idea how to find each other. And because of course they were used to, you just communicate with somebody when you don't see them. Whereas our generation would have first done what? We would have said, if you get lost, this is where we're going to meet, right? You negotiate your universe differently. And Butler is talking about more in the sort of cyber world of seeking information. But and then you've got people like us. We're digital immigrants, right? And some immigrants assimilate in the new culture very easily, and then other immigrants don't. So you have some people who, I'll use my brother for an example. When I'll send him an email and he picks up the, he won't text. Somehow doesn't feel like a connection. Right? He's got to talk to me on the phone. He lives in New Zealand. It's very inexpensive to call, but he won't email back and forth because it doesn't feel like to him like he's making a connection. So we negotiate our world. I figured all of this out in one class when I was trying to get hold of my daughter and I was calling her and she wasn't answering the phone. Well, I know what she was saying. She was saying, oh, it's bad. Right? But then I thought, okay. And I wrote her a text, my first text, I was 8 years ago. And I said, it was actually, you were thinking, do you want to go to LA? It was like, it's first spontaneous thing. But then I knew, that's just about LA. But she read my text. My like you're able to, right now, a lot of you have, truth time. How many of you sent a text or received a text during the last 2 hours? I got an email from one of you while I was in here and I responded back. Right? But what kind of an impact is that having on you? It means that you're actually negotiating all that information in really complex ways. The news used to just be like one person talking. Now, what is happening on the news? You've got things going on at the bottom. You've got Twitter going, so you've got people responding back and forth to the news. Information is not just something that is statically on the web. It's actually coming back and forth. It is affecting who you are, how you think, and how you respond to the world. And so, and that has happened again and again and again. The Gutenberg Bible, that was something that really changed the way people negotiate. Do you know before that? In college, people had the lecture. Wait a minute, so something hasn't changed, has it? Well, that was the reason why people lectured, was because there was no efficient way of communicating except, in this way. It's kind of interesting that college hasn't changed significantly in, 400 years. So, I think next time you're going to kind of engage.
Wait, I want to add one more thing.
Yes, okay.
And this is around you all. I don't know how many of you listen to NPR, but this morning, there were a couple of comments. One was that Mr. Speaker in Stony Brook, the State University of New York, said that they're doing a new pilot because employers want students with experiential learning. So, internships are being increased, and it's something that we talk about all the time here, that it's more valuable on your dossier than the courses you took. So that experience is huge. The other thing, a couple of minutes later, was, and I don't know who it was, an employer, it was teaching an employer, who's asking new employees to read and assigning them articles. You had a story attached to that. Assigning them readings because many of the people, young people they hire, are not used to reading and being able to distill the essence.
And that's actually one of the complexities of the way we get information now. It tends to be a little bit in pieces. So the idea of actually reading something that is sustained and long and takes more than, how many characters is a tweet? 140? Everything is in such bits and bytes that it actually is more difficult for that your generation. I mean, there's a plus and a minus. The plus is obviously you are able to take in information and to send it out so fast. It just makes you feel a little noisy. Thanks. It boggles the mind. I don't know what the captain is.
I think they want to wrap it up.
Okay. Okay. So you should have sent me a text and said, "Hey, wrap it up." I would have gotten it right here. Okay. So we'll see you on Wednesday.